Good morning, everyone. What a beautiful day, huh? On this new morning and in every moment of our lives, gracious God, from generation to generation, we praise your name. Like our ancestors before us, we proclaim your greatness to our children, for we have seen your deeds of power and witnessed your goodness in our lives. As you have opened your hand to all, satisfying the desire of every living thing, open our hearts, dear God, so that we might share the gifts we have received from you. Let us worship God in gratitude and joy. Would you pray with me, please? Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name this day and all days, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and hum along to a song together.
Blessed be your name today, Lord. Thank you.
Amen. You can be seated. And now is the time of the service when we get to lift our praises, our concerns, our needs before our God in heaven, and He hears every prayer. And thankfully, He hears every prayer spoken and unspoken. So let's just take some time and share with our Father in heaven. Lord, we're so thankful that we're a church that gathers, even in the midst of this unfounded fear, which I don't know where it's coming from and why it's affecting so many people, God. You, throughout Scripture, tell us, don't fear. Be strong in who I am as your God and who I created you to be in my image. So we thank you, Lord, and pray that your peace would overwhelm the fear, wash it away. Safely gathering in your name, God, is healing. And listening to the birds and feeling the breeze, feeling the sun. There's so much to be thankful for and to celebrate. And seeing all of us here, I pray for those who are at home that they would get a sense of connection and hope and peace and joy. That even as they tune in on their monitors or tablets or phones or whatever device, God, that you would work through the technology through and create something personal, a personal touch, a personal connection, so that we literally feel connected to your body, Jesus. You are the head, and every member is important. We need that connection. Transcend the technology and the airwaves and the buffering, God, and we know that your connection is sure and strong and robust and powerful. So fill us with your Spirit and help us to shine your light ever more gloriously around us, God. And may that touch people and give them a sense of hope and guidance and calibration to seek you, God. We love you and we thank you for all that you're doing. We trust you. Though most of the headlines end with question marks, God, we know that you are a God of exclamation points and periods. Your plans are sure and solid and complete. And that's what we cling to. And that's what we dance to, God. Pray that your spirit of joy, of calm, of peace, of assurance would continue to build us up to be your people of calm and joy and connection and assurance to those around us that so need a word, your word, God, from us. And that might be the only peace that they get to experience, God. So use us powerfully to do your work in this world. And Lord, we thank you for the words that Jesus, your Son, gave us. When we don't have the words to pray, we have these words, the Lord's Prayer. And we all say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I don't really have many announcements, but thank you, Jane, for letting us all know that Rachel Waldstein actually got out of India and found a flight and is now home in the U.S. I think Sue Mino is here as well, but we'll continue to sleuth that out and find out what's going on there. Wednesday night is... we're going to restart the all-church prayer at 7 p.m. Again, bring your own chair. It's just to follow the guidelines. And that's 7 p.m. this Wednesday. Right, we missed it last week because of weather. So this is rescheduled from last week. Yep, first Wednesday prayer. Well, what a pleasure and a blessing to be here with you all. Good morning. I just wanted to embrace this idea of caring for the sick. You know, what causes sickness? We've all been sick, and Scripture tells us that there's many causes of illness. Sickness can be caused by sin. Sickness can result from fear and stress, and we've talked about that before. Sickness can be directly from Satan. And even we ourselves can cause illness and sickness. Sickness can be situational. And we're all well aware that sickness can seem to come out of nowhere, suddenly manifest from the unlikeliest of places, and then just quickly sweep over our planet. There's many causes of sickness in the world. But here's what matters, however. It's not necessarily the reason for sickness, but God is looking at our response to sickness. And that's what God is looking for, how we respond as his people. As human beings, we do have several options in how we respond to sickness. There's the Hindu response, which basically says that illness is an illusion. Any sickness or difficulty in life is not really happening. It's all in your mind. It's almost like being in the Matrix. You need to free your mind. Sure, everything looks real, but there's no reality here. As you can imagine, this is pretty dangerous thinking, and there are even some branches of religion that call themselves Christian that believe this. And so much harm has been done in the name of religion and Christianity. And you know what this kind of thinking really is? I'm just going to call it what it is. It's denial and delusion, I believe, in the form of mental games. You know, it's attempting to deny existence, and I'm telling you, if we do this, that will make you sick. In fact, it's unbiblical to respond that way. Here's what Jesus says in John 16, verse 33. In this world, you will have trouble and suffering, but take courage. I have conquered the world. So to try and deny sickness and continue to play deluded mental games to try and get out of it when faced with trouble and sickness, Jesus just says that's sinful. And this will make you sick. Scripture says that the wages of sin is actually death. So we've got to free ourselves from this sinful thinking and living, because that will kill us. Here's another approach to illness. Buddhism says that you should have an attitude of indifference. Meaning, when you go through any suffering, just try not to feel it. You know, does that sound reassuring or comforting? That doesn't comfort me. Man, I just got this diagnosis. Well, ignore it. Wow, this pandemic is pretty scary, right? Don't let it bother you, because it's all karma. You know, we've heard that word karma before. What is karma? Karma, in essence, boiling it down, just basically says you get what you deserve in life. You do good things, you can expect good things. You do not so good things, you can expect not so good things. So if you have suffering in your life, karma says you did something to deserve it. Yikes, that doesn't really comfort me. You know, I happen to know a lot of people who got sick who don't deserve it, right? We all know people who got sick who don't deserve it. Do we human beings really, do we deserve this pandemic? So I don't buy this response either. I remember Larry King interviewing the Dalai Lama, and Larry King asked him, what would you say to the victims of Katrina or Rita? And you know what the Dalai Lama said? Nothing. What? Why? Because Buddhism believes if you've got bad things in your life, you just got to deal with them. You deserve it. Another approach is the Muslim or Islamic approach, which says that any sickness, any trouble is the will of Allah. In other words, God willed it, and therefore you just need to accept it and deal with it. Que sera, sera, right? Whatever will be, will be. That's pretty fatalistic if you ask me. And again, not really comforting. And the final attitude that we can approach is stoicism. This came out of ancient Greek philosophy, which basically says just grin and bear it. You know, tough it out, buddy. Have a stiff upper lip and power through it. It's a willpower approach to illness. That's going to make you sick, I guarantee it. That's also, some people call it American machoism. You know, we see it in like the Clint Eastwood movies or Dirty Harry or Rambo or John Wayne, if you grew up watching them. I think of that knight from Monty Python who just keeps on fighting King Arthur. You know, it's only a flesh wound. Well, no, it isn't. Your arm's cut off. 'Tis but a scratch. But you've got no arms left. Come here! I'll bite your legs off! Funny, but also deluded and still not very comforting. So what's the Christian approach to suffering, to pain, and particularly to sickness? Well, here's the Christian approach. Compassion, mercy, tenderness, caring. Listen to Matthew chapter 14. Jesus had compassion on them and healed their sick. You know, Jesus had compassion. He empathized with them. His heart broke for them, and he went right over to them. You know, even when his friends told him not to. You know, thank God Jesus didn't respond in some of these other ways we've just looked at. Amen? I mean, get over it. It's your fault, really. This is God's will, so buck up. Or what if he responded like the Dalai Lama? Just walked right on by and said nothing. I mean, praise God, Jesus looked into their eyes. He looks into our eyes when we need him. You know, if we're going to be like Jesus, which that's our work in this world, we have to learn to be compassionate people when there's sickness around us, you know, when people don't feel well. The truth is, we want others to be compassionate to us when we're sick, yes? I mean, it's the golden rule, remember that? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If we're going to become like Christ, and this world needs more of Christ, right, people? Amen? We must develop hearts of compassion. So how do we develop compassion, you might ask? I would say, thank you for asking, here are just a few steps, and these are, I believe, ingredients to compassion. The first ingredient to compassion is thoughtfulness. Here's what this means. Pay attention. That's the starting point. Be aware. Pay attention. Really look at people like Jesus did. Listen to them. And you know, there are people in pain all around us, all the time. Most of us don't notice because we don't have our antennas up. So it all starts with thoughtfulness, paying attention. Who's our model for this? Well, God, thankfully, in Psalm 106, God saw their misery and heard their cry. Did you notice his awareness? You know, there's seeing and there's hearing. That's the first ingredient to compassion. Today's English version says, he took notice of their distress. When you're distressed, God notices. When I'm distressed, God is attentive. And as his people, so should we. Do you do that? I'm asking myself these questions too. Do I do that? When people in your life are distressed, do you notice it? You know, when your friends or your neighbors or your co-workers or your relatives get sick, do you notice? You know, that's the starting point if you're going to help someone. We've got to be aware. We've got to pay attention. We've got to care enough to be aware. If you care, you will be aware. You know, God is testing us. He's watching us to see how we're going to respond to those in need around us. Do you respond to people's needs the way he does? Do you respond to people in pain the way Jesus would? Are you learning the most important lesson in life, which is how to love? You know, you can accomplish all kinds of things, but if you don't learn how to love, then you're missing one of the major points, I believe, in life, one of the primary purposes of life. So caring for the sick is not some minor part of life. It's one of the major things that God wants us to learn. In Matthew 25, Jesus talks about what it's going to be like on that final day of judgment when we all stand before God. And Jesus says this, then the king, which is Jesus, will say to those on the right, come you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you invited me into your house. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. Then these righteous ones are going to reply, Lord, when did we do this? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and gave you something to drink, or a stranger and show you hospitality, or naked and gave you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you. And the king will tell them, I assure you that when you did it unto one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me. Notice what Jesus says. I was sick and you cared for me. It doesn't say I was sick and you healed me, or I was sick and you tried to take all the pain away. It just says you cared for me. You know, here on earth, God doesn't want us to solve problems necessarily. What does he want us to do? He wants us to serve people. That's what matters to him. So do you care? Do I care? We can't solve the problems of the world. No human can. But the real issue is, do we care? Do we serve? Not necessarily solve, but definitely serve. Here's the second ingredient of compassion, presence. Presence means you just show up. Listen to Psalm 38, verse 11. Because of my sickness, no friends or neighbors will come near me. That's King David, and he writes this. Many of us are afraid to admit. He admits it. Most of us are probably uncomfortable around sick people. We're uncomfortable around sickness, illness, and dying. It's nothing that we innately seem to be very good at. In fact, what we seem to be better at is actually moving away from people who are sick. And I wonder why. You know, maybe it's because we don't know what to do or say. That's troubled me. You know, when we're not alone and feeling this way, because King David just told us that he needed people who weren't there. Even the Apostle Paul needed people. Many of us are familiar with Philippians 4, right? 4 verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But do we know the next verse? Verse 14, nevertheless, it was kind of you to share my troubles. The truth is, God has wired all of us with a desperate need of other people. We need each other. God knew that, and he put us together that way. Isaiah 63 says, in all their troubles, he was troubled too. He didn't send someone else to help them. He did it himself in person. And then the same verse in another translation, in all their troubles, it was no messenger or angel, but his, God's presence that saved them. In his love and pity, he himself redeemed them. Praise God. Presence, when we're sick, when we're suffering, our Father is sick and suffering, and he shows up. Amen? And that's exactly what God asks us to do for each other. Here's the next ingredient to compassion, acceptance. You know, it's not a sin to be sick. Sickness is certainly not evidence of a lack of faith in my book. It's not a sin. It's just a part of being human. There's no shame in physical illness, and there's no shame in mental illness. There's no shame in emotional illness. I've had all three, friends, and if you were honest, some of us did too. Everyone has mental issues. Everyone has emotional issues, and certainly everyone has physical issues. We're not alone. This is the reality of being human and just going through this life. The Bible says we hold God's treasure in these jars of clay. Clay jars are fragile. They're easily broken. So we're all cracked pots. Yes? Amen? We're all a little cracked and scraped up. No one's got it all together, mentally, emotionally, physically. Scripture says that there's no shame in this, however. It's not a sin to be sick, so why do we so often grin and bear it, pretending that everything's fine? We need each other, and we need to allow others to help. Paul says this in Galatians 4, even though my illness was a trial to you, you know, when we care enough to show up, we are helping shoulder the burden of sickness and trouble with others. That's what we do when we show up. Even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn, Paul says. Instead, you welcomed me as if I were Christ Jesus himself. When we show up in empathy and concern, God shows up in empathy and concern. We carry his presence in these fragile bodies. And I think that's pretty cool. Here's the next ingredients, hope. How about some more hope, huh? I'd love some more hope. One of the greatest things we can do with people who are ill is give them hope. People can handle almost anything in life if they have hope. When we don't have hope, we have a difficult time handling anything. Listen to Proverbs 18, verse 14. Your will to live can sustain you when you're sick, but if you lose it, your hope is gone. People need hope. They need to have hope. So how do we give people hope? Kind words are good medicine. It's medicinal. It's therapeutic to give people hope. It's good for them and it's good for us too. Offer encouragement. You can do this. You know, when I'm here and we're going to get through this together, that's offering hope. You know, some people are barely hanging on, friends. Maybe even some of us are holding on to that little bit of thread, right? That last little bit. Many of us could really use some encouragement right now. You never know when a word of encouragement is going to do something powerful in someone's life. Here's the next ingredient, scripture. Amen. Scripture. The best way to improve your health is to follow God's word. Follow his instructions for life. It'll prevent a lot of unnecessary problems. And I've seen that in my life. Just spend time reading this book. Proverbs 4, 21 to 22 says, "Don't ever forget my words," God says. "They're the key to life and they bring health to the whole body." God made an amazing promise to his people in Exodus 15. He said this, "If you obey my commands and you keep my rules, I will not bring on you any of the sickness I brought on the Egyptians." Wow. In other words, we're going to avoid a lot of illness just by doing what God has asked us to do. But we can't just read this book, right? That's not what this book is about. We can't just know it. God wants us to do it. That's the challenge. Here's the final ingredient, prayer. So important. We need to talk to God. We need to turn to God and ask for his help. All healing comes from God. Amen. God can heal through doctors. He can heal through medicine. God can even do a miracle. God heals many people in different ways. James chapter 5 says, "Confess your sins to each other. Pray for each other that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and wonderful results." Notice that James doesn't say confess to a doctor or confess to a counselor or a therapist or even a priest, pastor, or minister even. James says confess to each other. You know, when we have enough courage and trust to confess our sins to each other, pray for each other, God says there's healing there. We're all ministers, friends. We need to turn to each other. Listen to verse 14 in James. We need to turn to each other. "If you are sick," James says, "call for the church leaders. Have them pray for you and anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord." So what's the significance of the oil? We've talked about this before. We know that there's no power in the oil. The oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. Water is also a symbol of the Holy Spirit. That's why we use water in baptism. The water in baptism isn't any special water, right, that we have to purchase from holywater.com. It's just water. The water in baptism isn't special. It's just a symbol of God's Spirit and God's presence. Yes? Oil is also a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And I love this. We do this here. I love taking a few drops of oil, and I like to make the sign of the cross on someone's forehead as I'm praying. It's a physical symbol of God's presence. We're inviting his presence right here. And it's an assurance that he is here. Amen. We're not depending on ourselves. Nothing magical. There's nothing mystical. Nothing uncomfortable or nothing weird about it. We do it all the time here at church and when I visit people. If there is a concern or a sickness or if there's any need as I visit people, I pray with them and ask them if they'd like to be anointed, and some say yes. This is something that we should all be doing with each other. You know, there's no science to it. When I was in seminary, I didn't take a course on the theological significance and praxis of biblical anointing. Just do it. You know, it doesn't have to be me even. It doesn't have to be an elder or a church leader. Is there a special oil you have to get at holyoil.com? No, there isn't. Not really. I mean, for me personally, I probably wouldn't use canola. Definitely wouldn't use engine oil. But many translations tell us it's just common olive oil. And you don't dump the whole bottle on someone. I don't think they'd appreciate that. I just put a little on my fingers. Would you like that, McKenna?
No.
Glug, glug, glug.
No.
You don't even have to make the cross. I like to because it just reminds, it, everything points to God. But as you just touch the person with the oil on your hand, say a prayer, very simple, something like this. Father, we recognize that there's no power in this oil. It's just a symbol of your presence and your power. It's a symbol of our total reliance on you. Bless the one we anoint today. And then share the need or the concern or the request for healing. I also like to sing a chorus of a song with everyone involved. Why? Well, doing this shouldn't feel weird. Maybe it will feel a little awkward, right? If you haven't done it before, that's okay. But it should feel different. It shouldn't feel common. And it should feel sacred. And when it feels this way, you know that God's Spirit is moving and working. All the more reason to spend a little more time in His presence. Amen? Offer a song. If there are others involved, try a unison scripture reading. Or a call and response. You know, anointed prayers can really be powerful. You can anoint your home with oil. You know, the lintels, the doorways. This is important. The windows, the support beams, the areas of your house maybe that you aren't in that often. This is so important because all throughout Scripture we're assured that God is our ever-present help. So if the oil signifies His presence, how wonderful to remember that even in our homes, God is there. You can anoint your children as they go off to school. Wait a minute, Pastor, go off to school? Sorry, I mean as they sit down at the dining room table and log into Google Classroom. Parents can anoint each other as they face another semester of homeschooling. Keep that in your prayers, please. Return, open up our schools. If your pets are sick, you can anoint your pets. It's okay. You know, we're the stewards of God's creation, showing concern for the animals entrusted to us. It's a wonderful thing to do. My point is all of us should be ready and willing to anoint with oil when the Spirit lets us know it's time. You know, as always, after every message, here's the question. What are you going to do? What am I going to do? Will we do anything about this and the sick people in our lives? Or are we going to walk away saying, nice message? The truth is there are sick people all around us. The last verse is a verse that I've been praying for each and every one of you. 3 John verse 2 says this, I'm praying that all is well with you and that your body is as healthy as your soul is. So powerful prayer. God is interested in your body. He's interested in all our bodies. He's interested in our souls. I'm interested in your health and your wellness of your body and your soul. I'm praying that your body is as healthy as your soul is. God says, I want you to be healthy in both your physical body and your spiritual body. So God commands us to care for the sick. One of the things we're going to be judged for at Christ's return is how we treated the sick. Jesus says, I was sick and you cared for me. You know, sometimes we call Jesus the great physician. Have you heard this? He's the cure to every ailment in life. Guilt, worry, depression, fear, bitterness, anger, loneliness, pain, everything. Amen. I don't want you to be, you know, I don't know what you need curing, what you need to be cured of. I don't know where you need healing. You may have been looking for all kinds of solutions to the pain that you're faced with. You're welcome here. You're not alone. You may have been self-medicating through any number of means. You're welcome here. You're not alone. But can I be honest? Those things don't work, do they? We need Jesus to heal our hearts. Amen. Let's bow for prayer. Father, dear Father, I have to admit that caring for sick people hasn't been on some of our agendas, God. Maybe we've been both afraid and perhaps judgmental of people who are sick. I ask you to forgive us, God. I want us all to learn to treat people the way you do, which is with compassion. Show me, show us, God, how we can make a difference in others' lives by paying attention, by showing up, speaking a word of hope,
And Lord, we ask you to heal the people who ask for it. If they're not able to ask, Lord, we pray that we're with them and that we're asking on their behalf. Precious Father, we know that you hear all our prayers, and we praise you and thank you for that truth. We pray this in Jesus' name. God's people said, amen. Amen. Just a quick reminder, we have offering plates here. As always, we're still accepting your gifts by mail. P.O. Box 346, Ashley Falls. It's also on the website. We've implemented online giving. We just thank you for your continued support of Greenwoods, even during this time. You all are so generous, and I praise you for that. Thank you.
Lord, tender mercy.
Man, that song gets me every time. People of God, may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, empowered and enabled by His Holy Spirit. Go in peace. God bless you.